Good morning, everyone. This is Saturday, April 9th, 2016. We welcome you all to our Bible study. This morning, our moderator is Luann from New York. Go ahead, Luann.
Morning, everyone. The reading is from Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures by Mary Baker Eddy. Through the wholesome chastisement of love, we are helped onward in the march towards righteousness, peace, and purity, which is the landmarks of science. Holding the infinite task of truth, we pause, wait on God, then push onward until the boundless thought walks enraptured and conception unconfined is winged to reach the divine glory.
Thank you.
Topic today is on the story of Naaman from 2 Kings chapter 5. Who was Naaman and what led him to Elijah?
Mary?
Good morning. I have you on speaker. We started.
Okay, thank you.
Well, wasn't Naaman the, he was the in charge of the military, the army of Syria?
Yeah, he was the chief commander.
Thank you.
And he was the guy who conquered Israel.
Yeah, he was second.
He was a leper. I'm sorry. He was a leper. He had leprosy.
Yeah, he was a great soldier, but he had this problem.
Yeah, he was second in command to the king, and then won many battles. Was highly respected. King counted on him. Sounded like this condition, perhaps it just come on him fairly recently. And what was leprosy in those days?
Skin disease.
Yes, it was a very awful, dreaded disease.
It was considered fatal.
Yes.
And contagious.
Contagious.
So they were separated. When they in separate areas of, they were separated from the general population normally. Yeah,
there were leper colonies, quarantined.
And if they did go around, they had to say unclean, unclean, so people knew that they were coming. And it damaged your nerves. You couldn't got where you couldn't feel. You were insensitive. They considered it almost like being dead. It was, at that time, one of the worst, because you were isolated, you were going to...
And it was thought that it came from... came because you were sinful in some way.
Yes.
I also read that it was very common in Syria, but it didn't exclude him from the society because Jewish law was not enforced there.
Okay.
Yeah, those things are important to understand how important it was for him to be healed of this. And I read, too, it said whenever Jesus healed a leper, he pronounced the person not healed but cleansed. So I guess that has something to do with the idea of being sinful. They had to wear a black hood and live outside the city walls. What did you say, Luann, about Matthew Henry being, spiritual leprosy or something like that?
Yeah, he described Naaman's case as spiritual leprosy.
Okay.
That's very appropriate, isn't it? It's a cleansing.
Yeah.
And I guess it was the type of disease where you're willing to do just about anything for a cure. Anything. Which is always a good state to be in. And only when you do that do you begin to have hope of getting out of that condition where you are totally on your knees before God in submission.
I thought it was interesting how this chapter opens up describing Naaman. You know, he was host of the king, honorable, gave him great deliverance, a mighty man, and something tells me that he heard all about it repeatedly from his people there, and that's not a healthy thing to have thrown at you and to allow to come in. That leads to this insensitivity, more or less this spiritual leprosy that was mentioned earlier.
And, you know, here he had, it would seem, everything, position, money, power, things that people consider everything. And yet he was stricken with this. So, just a reminder.
And let's see how much the money will cure it.
Exactly. That we're coming to that, aren't we?
So what led him to Elisha? Kind of a circuitous route, wasn't it?
Yeah.
A little maid from Israel, that was taken from Israel, said that if the God of Israel was the God of Samaria, that would be healed.
Recommended that he go see the prophet.
Who else was speaking?
They went to see the king of Israel.
Yeah, they didn't know who the prophet was, did they?
No.
But what was so extraordinary?
Almost fell apart. Yep.
What was extraordinary about this little maid, though?
It was her innocence and her purity and her love, even though she was a captive.
Yeah, it was. Thank you. I mean, would you feel so benevolent if you had just been taken as a slave, taken from your home, taken from your family? She could have just said, "Yeah, you're doomed to die, buddy."
I read she was a servant of choice, and since she was of choice, they seek their master's good. So to me, it was like she was grateful that she was chosen.
Well, that's good.
She certainly did care.
She did, and it does bring that out, that there was love. There had to have been love. But still, under those circumstances, she was an extraordinary little maid. That's probably why they loved her. And because they loved her, she loved them. But were you going to say something else, Florence? Someone?
Oh, I was going to say the way the whole thing unfolds, yeah, maybe there was God's hand was in it too. You know, how she is chosen and so that the lessons can be learned.
Very true.
Yeah.
Everyone was being sent.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he obviously treated everybody very well. He says he was honorable. So she was literally treated very well. Love is reflected in love.
And she served his wife. I'm sure his wife was kind to her.
Somebody mentioned that. Go ahead, Mike.
In the first verse of that chapter 5, it talks about how Naaman had, because of the Lord, had given deliverance into Syria. And Matthew Henry says that he did have a certain ability to listen to the true Lord, even though Syria was worshiping idols, etc. And the other thing that was very remarkable about him was that he had the ability to listen to people like the maid, even though he was in a high position.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So he had somewhat of an open thought.
Along that line, I had read something from a commentary that said, the girl must have had something about her to make those people listen to her. She must have shown her religion in her life. Her life must have been consistent with her religion to make them believe her. We read that Naaman had faith in her word, and he goes to the king and tells him what he intends to do.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Very important point. You know, throughout history, the condition and position of slaves is often very horrendous. And yet, those who are somehow able to find their God and continue to do the right thing, they can do tremendous good. And they do tremendous good, really. And in many ways, the ones who should be pitied and the ones who are the spiritual lepers are not the slaves, but whom?
Captors.
Yes.
Those who do the enslaving.
Yes. Those are the ones who need the most help, really.
That interview that is on the website about spirituals, it says in there that the slaves were not impressed with their captors' Christianity. I always thought that was funny. Catholics trying to convert them, but they're not doing anything good.
That's true. That is such a beautiful story, and that is really, in many ways, what I was thinking of. That story was it Joe Carter,
yeah.
The Additional Gems page, which is under the Audio Library tab.
Yeah, if any of you haven't listened to that, it will cause you to
weep.
And in their dire need, the slaves found God, the Bible, the story of Moses. I mean, they hadn't heard a lot of these stories, and they came up with these beautiful songs and came through tremendous adversity. And they were really absolutely the more spiritually minded than the slave masters.
Would you mind repeating where we can find that?
It's on the Additional Gems page, which you can find under the Audio Library tab on the main page of the website.
Thank you.
We usually feature it on Martin Luther King Day, and we do feature it. It's something beautiful. I think it was something Peter found a few years ago, and it's well worth listening to. Just a beautiful story that reaches deep within you and gives you a whole perspective on a lot of things, a needed perspective. So thank you, Linda. Anybody else on the little maid? That was beautiful what Linda read about her, and so true. Sure, she had a Christliness. She knew God. Didn't matter. She was a servant or a slave. She knew God, and that's always the important thing. That's what counts. That's what matters. Not your so-called position in life. Although it would seem otherwise. Never forget that. If you find yourself in what would be considered a lowly servant position, doesn't matter. If you're expressing the Christ truth, that's all that matters. And if you do that, God will lift you up and out. You remain faithful to Him.
Or for the other way, if you're like Naaman in a really high position, Oh, that doesn't matter either.
No, that does not matter.
So he trusted her that there was a prophet in Israel, but he didn't know who it was, did he?
He was ready to go.
No.
He was ready to go. So then what happened?
Well, he went to the king and then told him. And the king kind of was the one who bollocked it up and said, well, I'll send you to the other king.
He thought the prophet was the king of Israel.
How could it be otherwise? The king is the...
King's the top guy, right?
Yeah.
So he must be the one.
He's the man.
Mm-hmm. He can fix things.
Yeah.
Just like he's in charge. This guy has to be in charge.
So he sent Naaman to the king of Israel.
And he told the king of Israel, thou mayest recover him of his leprosy.
Right.
And
so that gets us to question number two, I guess, right?
No, we're not done.
You're not done?
No, what went with him?
A letter.
A letter?
A letter.
He took clothing and, I think he took some money, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of money.
A lot of money. I read the money. 10 talents of silver is worth $182,000.
Oh. And a lot of clothes, of beautiful clothes, right?
Yeah. Yes, silk clothes. And then 6,000 shekels of gold is worth $2,390,000. Now, think of it. Think of how 6,000 shekels of gold. I don't know what a shekel looks like. Think of all these talents of silver. They had a caravan of donkeys, a lot of them, okay? It wasn't just a couple people trotting into town. This was this huge caravan of gold and silver and fine raiment. All the money that you could ever wish for. I mean, this is how highly this king thought of Naaman. Let's do this, okay? Whatever you want, I'll give you. We'll pay them, and they'll get you well.
Going to the best hospital.
Exactly. Finest doctors.
Absolutely.
Spare no expense.
I don't think those hospitals won't charge you.
Oh, yes.
I know. This $2 million is probably nothing anymore.
You might have to bring another caravan.
And they had guards to guard it all, you know.
Right. Then you got to worry about guarding it all, yes. Mm-hmm. They had a huge amount. And not only that, with the mules, there were also the horses and the chariot. I mean, they said you must have seen it for miles around. Coming. So that is that I didn't know. That's a huge point. I never thought about how much stuff that was, how much money. And money is the answer, isn't it? Money will get you anything. Yes, it will. So they think. Okay, so then what happens? Now we're in the next question again.
So the king of Syria sends a letter before time to let the king know that he's coming. And I think, like in Matthew Henry, it was kind of interpreted as a sense of, you know, this guy is coming into Israel and you need to help him get to Elijah. But the king interpreted it wrongly, thinking that he was to do this cure. How did the king of Israel interpret the letter from the king of Syria?
He thought it was his close, didn't he?
And the king of Syria probably didn't know any better. You know, he's saying the king of Israel, someone there.
Oh, my God. He probably was scared, but he sees now that there's a letter saying, well, can you cure this guy? And he's saying, well, how am I going to do that? I'm not God. How can I? And he thought that, oh, he's trying to pick a fight with me and invade the country.
Yeah, he thought he was trying to entrap him,
mm-hmm.
start a fight.
Can you imagine seeing all this millions of dollars and saying, you know, you got to cure some person? He doesn't have the least idea how to do it. But it also shows what about this guy?
Absolutely no spiritual sense.
He doesn't even think, you know, about his prophet, Elijah.
Exactly.
Doesn't even occur to him, and yet the prophet's around there.
I know. That's it. Talk about personal sense. Me, myself, and I. He didn't even think. I mean, he thought, oh, my gosh, it's all about me. It's all about
the
me.
King.
Yeah,
he even he tore his clothes. He was so upset.
Crying.
Right. Grieving. Yeah. Who said no spiritual sense? He jumped right into it. Talk about lack of prayer or even, you know, hey, wait a minute, let me think about this for a minute.
Well, and think about the situation they were in. That was that kind of thought that got him into this mess in the first place, that they were under Syria's rule.
Hmm.
They weren't even independent anymore.
Tom, did you want to say anything?
No, I don't have anything at the moment.
Well, it to me, it's amazing that he didn't even think of Elisha the prophet. I mean, that shows something huge. Yeah, obviously,
I
think much of
Elisha. Sorry.
Go ahead.
I think just, sorry. Go ahead, sorry.
Really explain.
Oh, I think it's... Oh, wow. I'm sorry.
Explains why they got into this mess in the first place.
Go ahead, Shardy.
Well, I was just, I mean, this is a good lesson. I mean, something scary comes to you or you think is scary, you better pay attention to God. I think, for me, it's a big lesson.
Thank you. That's bringing it home.
Mm-hmm.
I think
yeah.
it's... You know, I think it also is a lesson for the human maneuvering that we think we can do to get what we want instead of waiting for God's direction, his way of bringing what good there is for you. You know, you say, oh, I know such and such in this position in such a place. You know, maybe I can write to them or that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But that's why it says to leave it alone, leave the outlining or the human maneuvering and let God do what he's doing.
Yes. Who else is trying to speak?
It's not being mesmerized.
Yeah.
By the animal magnetism, it's not being mesmerized, not getting into the error and believing in it.
Absolutely. Linda?
Yeah,
I was just going to share, while I was doing this Bible study, I found out that Jesus had used the story of Naaman and Elijah as an illustration of Israel's problem of unbelief. In Luke 4:27, he tells the crowd, there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elijah the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian.
Very good. Thank you.
I was just going to say before that obviously the king didn't even know who the heck Elijah was.
Well, that to me is astounding.
Well, he might have seen the miracles, but maybe he'd just forgotten about them or didn't believe them.
Absolutely.
Well, that's what I meant. I mean, whether he physically ever knew about them or spiritually, he obviously didn't know about them spiritually. I should have defined it.
What happens to people that think they're in a high position and that they're personally responsible for everything that goes on there? Absent God, so to speak, and here's a prophet who in his eyes would not be in a high position and yet doing all the good works because he let God work through him.
Yeah, but it's definitely an example of this lack of, who cares what miracles people do? You know, everybody says, show me the money, show me the miracles. And then the miracles happen, and no one even remembers them or thinks about them. That's what a big impression it has on some people. So that's
fine. The king of Israel undoubtedly knew about Elijah.
He did. He didn't. I'm sure he probably did, but he didn't remember.
and he didn't respect it enough.
He didn't respect it enough or think highly of it. He thought highly of himself. This is a classic case of personal sense and me. And as the other huge thing is what Shardy started out saying, you get some huge thing come at your door like that. I mean, somebody with millions of dollars and telling you this, and you just jump right in the human mind, don't even think about God, take it all on yourself. Think about that, and if you think it doesn't happen, it does happen. I know it's happened to me, where I've just jumped in the human mind. I haven't quieted my thought and asked God, well, what's this all about? What's the answer here, Father? Instead, you just take the whole responsibility and get all upset and think someone's trying to start a war with you.
That's kind of the constant challenge of human life.
Yes.
I mean, exactly. That we must prove unreal.
A great example. Someone else, another commentary said, when the little maid spoke up on behalf of Elisha, that it said that there were no examples that Elisha had healed any, as Linda was saying, had healed any lepers before. But the little maid had such confidence in the prophet. She knew the prophet. She was a humble little soul. She knew that Elisha could do this, even though he'd never done it before. He said, oh, yeah, just go to the prophet Elisha. He'll help you. That was her. Her, in contrast to the king of Israel, who couldn't even think of who he was or what he does. This is the human mind versus spiritual thinking. And when someone is in the human mind, I don't want to hear about they want to see the miracles. Why weren't all these healings taking place in Mrs. Eddy's day? I'm telling you, that's gotten to be where I see a red flag go in front of my it is happening. It's people don't have the eyes to see it or the gratitude to appreciate it or even the interest in it. So don't tell me that. It's not true. That's a ploy of the devil. And I hear it, which is why I'm speaking to it. You take the example of that king of Israel who was blind, deaf, and dumb in the human mind, a little servant maid who got it all. What's the difference?
Or in spirit?
Yes. And well, you know, it's over and over in the Bible and in Science and Health. If you are in the human mind, the carnal mind is at enmity with God. It's not going to get it. So don't be discouraged if people don't get it or don't see it or don't understand it. They're just in the wrong mind. And until they wake up, they won't.
I guess it's hard being a king, you know, where you've got this huge amount under you and a lot of wealth and everything like that. It must be very hard.
Well, yeah, what is that, Mel Brooks, though? It's good to be king. That was a Mel Brooks movie. Anyway, no, it can be very hard, or it can be. Some people think it's very great to have all that money and all that power, but truly it isn't.
No, it's an unholy situation. If you think anything other than God is king, you're starting on the wrong premise. Because they're always having to worry about who's going to take them over. Who's going to kick them out.
Yeah, who's going to steal all their gold or all of that. It's just constant worry and responsibility. So that king, I mean, these are just classic examples of the human mind. That's what's so relevant about these Bible stories. We can apply them today and now. And remember this story. If ever you get faced with some situation that seems, wow, where'd this one come from? keep your peace and your poise and get back to God. Don't just throw it all away and get so upset.
Actually, that's just the excuse the kings use, or the leaders use in modern times, because it's only as lonely and as difficult as they make it, because they have the whole country at their disposal to fix everything if they were just willing to delegate and let people help them.
Yes.
Yeah, and some are not doing anything anyway, so why don't they have time to seek God?
Yeah, right.
I mean,
Okay, anybody else on this one?
I wanted to say about the king, this is the nature of the human mind. It always assumes the worst. Just goes to show where its eyes are focused instead of expecting the good.
Very good.
Some turning to God in some way.
Very good. Totally misinterpreted the whole thing. Saw the worst. I mean, if it hadn't been for Elisha, they probably could have started a war. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's how things mm-hmm. happen like that. Total false interpretation of what's going on. And it usually has to do with personal sense and me, myself, and I, and all of that. He jumped in the middle, and he didn't even know what the heck he was doing.
Huge, because he could have really gone deeper and deeper into mortal mind. It would have just been, oh, well, I better get ready. I better get my, you know, army or something. You know, all of that for nothing.
For nothing. And you take it to your level, you know, a fight with your husband or child or someone else, where it's all in your thought. There's a saying, you set the battle in array. It's in your thinking. You cause it to happen. Because it's what you're thinking and what you're seeing, and so you see it manifested. You're having a bad dream. And yet that isn't even what's going on at all. See how dangerous that can be. So it's all a bad dream. It's not the truth, but who needs to dream that bad dream? Yeah, as Bruce said, it was a very negative take on the whole thing. And it wasn't true.
So then what happened?
Well, didn't Elisha get in touch with the king?
Yeah, he heard about it.
Thank God. They didn't have cell phones, but...
You saw the king walking around, moping around, upset as can be. Tearing his clothes, putting ashes on his forehead.
because Elisha was around.
He wore that dream like a cloak. Yeah. And it's hard to get out of it when you're in it.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, no, it seems so real. So real, and yet it was all manufactured. In his head.
That's why we have practitioners.
True. To wake up the dream, see its unreality when you feel it's so real.
Now, one thing that's helped me to remind myself that healing does happen, but it happens on God's terms. So it gives me an opportunity to examine myself and see how close am I to God's terms, or am I more or less driven by my own expectations?
So the king didn't call his practitioner, but the practitioner heard about it.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah. Discern the need.
So why did he take up the case?
Told him.
And he said he will know that there is a prophet in Israel.
And not only that the God is the real God.
And Israel has the truth there, which they don't have in Syria.
And who was Elisha? Anybody give any background on Elisha?
Wasn't he the one that was... he worked with Elijah. And he was the one that asked for a double portion of his spirit when Elijah went up in the, I think it was a chariot of fire. Maybe I got that one wrong, but.
No, you got it right.
If you see me, Elijah told Elisha, if you see me, then the double portion will. Me to you.
Yes.
Right.
It's a beautiful story.
And that's a huge... The ability to see it. and it was going on, but the ability to see it is
exactly
a huge point.
Yes, have the eyes to see it. Who else is going to speak?
Well, before that happened, Elijah found Elisha in a field plowing. Elisha was the son of a well-to-do farmer. And when Elijah found him, he put his cloak around his shoulder, and Elisha knew. And they went, and he said goodbye to his parents. And they had a little celebration, and then he followed them. He lived his pendant for quite some time learning.
Yes, thank you. And
Elijah, he took to heart what he learned.
Yeah, Elijah performed many miracles, as did Elisha.
And he got a mantle from Elijah, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got the double portion of the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And all of the students in the prophet's school witnessed it and recognized that Elisha was the next top prophet, so to speak. So he was recognized as the most Christ-like thought at the time.
May I read some?
Oh, go ahead.
Before Elisha healed Naaman, it was that battle of Moab, and then it says this: back in Israel, Elisha resumed his mission, aiding the poor and afflicted. He traveled throughout the countryside on a donkey that was led by Gehazi, which we know what happened to him, a man who had attached himself. But anyway, he stayed with the people. He was very interested in helping all the people, and that's what I think is part of his wanting to help Naaman, even though he knew Naaman's lack of humility.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm sure he did. Someone said he felt very strongly that God says to help him. You know, in the practice, you'll feel that too. There's some people you just know God wants you to help. So. Okay, where are we, Luann?
Why did he decide to take up the case? Show that there was a prophet in Israel, and many of the kings that had prospered regarded their prophets the word of God, and they were better kings. But this king disregarded Elijah. So it was an opportunity to show that he was a true prophet and that the king should probably start listening to him. The king didn't have a relationship with his prophet. So I think this was an opportunity for Elijah to change that.
Thank you.
That was a good point. Yeah.
Good point.
You want to move on to number four?
Unless anyone else has anything else to say.
So it was truth forcing itself on mankind in a way.
Yeah, and Elisha didn't back down or have false humility there. He rose to the occasion. You can't do it, but I can. I was the one they came for, the one the little maid knew about.
I was thinking it was almost like curing two cases of spiritual leprosy one case.
Very true. The king.
And Naaman.
Matthew Henry writes that those that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercies. So that the Israelites had lost in battle to the Syrians, and they could have been helped if they paid more attention to their prophets and God.
Mm-hmm.
Good lessons for today.
For us all.
So Elijah doesn't. So Naaman goes to the door of Elijah, and Elijah sends out his servant to give him the message of
what to do.
I'll tell them to go dip in the go in the Jordan 7 times. And then Naaman got angry about that. So why was he so angry when he was given the message to wash in the Jordan?
Well, he had a preconceived idea of his importance, and he expected the prophet to just come and wave a wand over him. I mean, it was, you know, his own pride.
Yeah, his pride was hurt.
He was doing his version of personal sense.
Right. Well, can you imagine, I mean, loading up all these donkeys and all this gold, millions of dollars and chariots and trotting all that way to meet this prophet, and he doesn't even come to the door, for heaven's sake? He sends a messenger? I mean, they thought that was the height of being rude. And And yes, I'm sure it's fairly said he had these preconceived ideas. They were probably expecting some big magic show.
Expectations are the worst.
What a letdown.
Also, this guy, I'm sure, had been told for years how wonderful he was, the mighty man in valor, so he was used to hearing that sort of stuff and probably expected some recognition of the same thing.
It was so wonderful, Elisha's treatment of him. Didn't give him the time of day.
I think that was more the treatment than anything, right?
It was the treatment. You're absolutely right. Treatment, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other thing, what about the River Jordan?
That wasn't good enough either.
Oh, it was dirty. It was a muddy river. It wasn't as clean as the rivers in Syria.
Oh, fair.
Mm-mm. He really hit his pride, didn't he? Boy, oh, boy. I mean, leprosy hit his pride. That in itself is, talk about a humiliating and humbling experience to have something like that. If you can't hide it, right? Everybody knows about it. And then to be treated.
And here he was in the middle of this country that he had conquered. I mean, they were here to serve him, for heaven's sake. And the guy doesn't, you know, Elisha doesn't come out and bow down to him and wave his magic wand. I mean, he's got this attitude about Israel and his river. And he's having his nose rubbed in it.
If ever anything hit his pride, all of that did. And it was, it barely started out with the exact opposite of what he thought was going to happen. He had these preconceived notions. So, when you go to God or to a practitioner, do you have preconceived notions about what you expect to happen, what you expect to do, what you will do and what you won't do?
Like Naaman thought that Elijah was just going to wave his hand and he'd be cured. He wouldn't have to do anything. He was such a great man that Elijah would respect him so much and just have him, you know, sit in his chariot and he'd just wave his hand and then he could go back to Syria.
Right.
He didn't expect to have to do anything, to do any work.
And if that had happened in that way, what also would have happened? If Elisha hadn't treated Naaman in this regard,
he wouldn't have appreciated the healing.
And the leprosy probably would have come back.
He'd still be spiritually dead.
Yes, he would. He would not have learned one single thing.
And it may come back.
Yes, and that happens when people have a tremendous healing, and they haven't learned really what they need to learn. It appears to come back until they learn the lessons that are needed.
Because really the disease is the pride.
Absolutely.
It's hiding there, and he had no clue. He just went, oh, heal me of this and let me go, you know. And yet there was deeper or more latent thing to be addressed.
Absolutely.
And it's the difference between covering something up temporarily and clearing it up permanently.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And understanding versus belief.
Who's taking up the moral issues?
The lurking moral issues, as the lesson says this week. Now, and what Florence said is right. The disease and the pride are one and the same. Neither one is true. But
unless you get to the root of the problem,
yeah,
nothing is really healed.
The pride had to go. It had to. And if Elijah had done that, waved his magic wand, and Naaman would have gone back every bit as prideful as he was, maybe even more so.
Even more.
Yeah. He would have thought that his money bought him the cure.
Yeah.
Right, and that he deserved it.
He deserved it. Look what God did. He would have, yeah.
And he would probably have gotten leprosy again.
Yeah, oh, mm-hmm. He would. He would, because nothing really had changed. This is, you know, faith healing versus real Christian Science healing, where there is a transformation. Some people will see what they need to see and be transformed, but then it's a matter of what?
Maintaining.
Yes, humility and maintaining it. Keeping it. Not going back to the old ways. What does Mrs. Eddy say? That an error tempts you to repeat the offense. And there we are tried. So you can have a wonderful awakening and see what you need to see at times. But then if you go back to the old ways, that you, the old habits, the old man, yeah, you're going to end up starting at ground zero again and working your way back up, which is unnecessary.
You already know what that
something means. Worse could come up as well.
Something
it
worse.
It may not be leprosy. It may be worse than that.
Let's
you
see.
Don't.
I, the thing is, I've seen it. And people have, you know, they'll have healing, and they'll have another healing, and they have another healing. And eventually, they haven't really changed. Something else will happen, and that time, it's not going to work anymore.
This is such a great story about how to work with a practitioner, because I know for myself that I come to a practitioner for an instant healing, but on the other hand, when I was in that situation outside of Plainfield, the practitioners didn't want to delve into the depths or lift me up to a new spiritual level. It was much easier just to wave the hand and be done with it, and it took me quite a while to figure out that things weren't really healing, that they appeared to heal at the time, but it wasn't a true healing because the issue popped up in a different place in a just slightly different way, so I didn't recognize it as the same thing.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's important to understand how much love it really takes for a practitioner to delve into your thought and see things that aren't pretty. And point them out, because there's always, a backlash. When the error in your thought gets pointed out and brought to the surface, it's a very disturbing experience. And a lot of patients express hatred towards a practitioner, or are there unpleasant things when that happens?
As Naaman did. Mm-hmm. He was furious.
So for a practitioner to really do his or her job requires a lot of courage, requires a tremendous amount of love.
You think of how clearly Elisha saw this, how clearly he knew what Naaman needed, and he knew it because of his oneness with the Father, with God. And boy, did he deliver it, not even coming out to say anything to him, telling him to wash 7 times in a dirty river. You've got to be kidding me. But Elisha knew what he needed.
And what? He was impressed with all of the king's horses and the king's men either, or with the picture that, you know, he could be in real danger.
Absolutely not. Totally unimpressed. So Naaman is furious, so that now what happens?
He's ready to go marching off and go back home. And then his servants, I love this part, his servants talk to him and say, Father, you know, meaning, and I love that a couple different commentaries both said it was a term of respect and affection or love for this man. And they basically said, if he had asked you to do some great thing, wouldn't you have done it? How much easier is it just to go wash and be clean? And we had talked about this before, where Naaman had listened to what the little maid had said, and he took a second look and listened to what his servant had said.
Yes, it's a beautiful part of this story, and also for us, if you ever have a case like that, where you're with a hard nut, so to speak, you know, what gentle words can you say to turn their thought around so they get where they're doing the right thing? See, these servants were inspired by God. Again, it was the servants. The servants were the spiritually minded ones in this whole story. And they were the ones, and they spoke of the word, what is it, the word in season. The Bible speaks about being able to speak the word that heals and blesses and helps. That here he was enraged, and yet what the servant said clicked with him, made sense to him, how foolish he was being. And it calmed all that anger and got him back on the right track to do the right thing. Remember that in your own experiences when you're dealing with people who are enraged or somehow off the wall in some way. What ask God to give the right word to correct the situation.
Or if you're the one that's being angry, and I know I've been upset and had a dear friend, or sometimes it wasn't even somebody I knew well, would calmly talk, and you could see, oh, yeah, that's right.
That's it.
You could recognize the truth.
Yeah, I mean, if they had said the wrong thing, if they agreed, oh, yeah, yeah, that's really stupid, what the heck's going on with that, Elisha? I mean, that would have sealed the deal, right? You would have gone, they all marched off mad.
Come on, let's go back.
Yeah, let's go back. Let's get out of here.
Yeah.
Take our marbles and go home. Yeah. There's a beautiful Aesop fable, and it's in one of our 500 watching points. The story of a lion, a huge, proud, you know, they're the king of the jungle, and how it got ensnared in a net. Couldn't get.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. So, what saved it?
A mouse.
Mouse.
Little
mouse.
A little mouse.
Chewed the net.
And he had to wait patiently for the net to be chewed.
Yeah. He did. Hear this little mouse save this big lion. And Mrs. Eddie would say very often, you know, when she was in trouble, that's why she had her students. They could help her. They could change. She was not too proud not to accept help. And we must never be either. Is this the proud lion? The king of the jungle was not too proud. When he got in that situation, the little mouse helped him, and he was, I'm sure, very, very grateful for that little mouse. We must never be too proud. You never know who will say the right word or how it will come. Might come someone you think, maybe you think you don't think very much of, which isn't a good thing, but, you know, and they're the ones who help you in a situation. And they'll change your wrong opinion of them. So.
This reminds me of a statement that Mrs. Eddie makes somewhere in Prose Works where she says, "The little that I have been able to accomplish has all been done through love, through self-forgetful, patient, unfaltering tenderness."
Thank you.
That's beautiful.
Good lesson. This is an amazing story. I was amazed myself when I went over it, all the lessons in it that apply to us right here, right now. Okay, so where are we?
On the last question.
Okay.
What change had to come to Naaman before he could be healed?
He had to get on his knees in humility and obedience.
A little more humility.
Yes.
There's no substitute for humble obedience, is there?
No.
No, that's the overcoming.
Submission. Submission to the Word of God.
Yeah.
And, also,
is there ever a safer place in this world for any of us to be?
No.
On our knees.
And you know that obedience, Mrs. Eddie once told a student, because I think a student told her he couldn't obey until he understood. And what did she say?
Obey before you understand?
Yeah.
You can't understand until you obey.
Sometimes you can't. You're going to wait till you understand. You're going to be waiting a long time. Once you obey, then you get it. The obedience must come. You have to be willing to be obedient. That's the trust. That's the faith that's required of you. That's what all of this is talking about. It's the faith of obedience, even though it doesn't seem to make sense. I mean, really, think of it. How stupid. Dip in the Jordan 7 times? What does that have to do with anything? I mean, you could look at it that way. But it had everything. Because it required 2 things, obedience and humility, which are the 2 things Naaman needed in order to be healed. And we all have things we need in order
to be healed. We talked about this before, but when you come to a practitioner or anybody to be healed, you have to remember that if you knew the answer, you wouldn't need to come in the first place. So.
Exactly. Yes. Someone will come and then start quoting scripture to you or start, I know, I've read that, I've done this, just as the rich man, I have obeyed everything all my life, I'm perfect. What more do I need?
Well, you're here, though.
Right. So.
Actually, this is how it works when we learn anything. We take on faith what the instruction is and let the experience teach us. And we go on from there. You're not going to take a step until you understand it all. You're going to be stuck in the same spot.
Yes.
Thinking of what the servant said to Naaman about, you know, if he would do some great thing, you know, he would have gone on a quest and he would have killed a dragon. But that quest is like inside of us and the dragon's inside of us. We have to go after it in there, not somewhere else.
That's right. I can't quote it exactly in prose word. Now, Mrs. Eddy talks about a little more grace, the truth tenderly told, a motive made pure.
Made pure.
Yes. The list of 4 or 5 beautiful things.
Heart softened.
A heart softened.
Character subdued.
Yes, thank you.
And a life consecrated.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And that will do. Does anyone have that quote? It will do more for you. I mean, this is what brings healing. It's a beautiful statement. One to think about. Thank you, Fairley and Florence. One to be familiar with. You know, that was one thing with Mrs. Evans. She'd gotten on fire with prose work, which I'd never even really read much of. And she gave us so many incredibly beautiful quotes from that to learn, to work with, to live. That was one of them. Beautiful statement. Kind of simplifies the whole thing, makes it all manageable.
I have it if you want me to read it.
I will, thank you.
Yes.
A little more grace, a motive made pure, a few truths tenderly told, a heart softened, a character subdued, a life consecrated, would restore the right action of this mental mechanism and make manifest the movement of body and soul in accord with God.
Thank you. That's a beautiful ending to this Bible study. That's the truth. That's what Naaman needed. That's what he got. He had a wonderful healing. Thank God for it.
And his servants helped him along the way.
His servants helped him. The angel thought, and he was wise enough to listen.
Closer to God.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Luann.
Thank you.
Thank you, Luann.